Isn't storytelling on Sunday afternoon a gift?
Yeah.
And part of that gift is from Nick Smith. Now, most of you know him, but if you don't, you may not know that he's been a backbone of the Pasadena Folk Music Society, and you see him running around the festival, listening to people, looking for talent, booking talent. And he does the same thing in the folk community. He has been part of the SoCal traditional storytelling community, the LA Storytelling Festival. He is an ardent contributor to the National Storytelling Listserv. And in the midst of all his work, all his music, you can find him online day after day. He has an opinion about this and an opinion about that. But you didn't know that about him, right? He's a multifaceted storyteller, and I will never, ever forget listening to Nick tell me the true story of Hang Down Your Head, Tom Dooley. Let's see what he's got in store for us today. Please welcome Nick Smith.
You wouldn't think it, but I used to tell stories at Irish fairs and festivals. Now, what made this unusual was that the big Irish fair in Los Angeles was held at that time at a horse race track. The Santa Anita racetrack in Arcadia was the home of the big Irish fair for several years, and it was an odd location because you had a bunch of stages and a bunch of different places, and there was a big storytelling stage. But one year, one of the storytellers said, "You've got to come down to the end. The Queen's asking for you." Well, first off, I didn't know who he could be talking about because, yes, there was always a queen of the festival, but that wasn't where she was. No, Queen Maeve. And that was when I was shown the secret place at the fair. The Queen Maeve encampment was not a modern Irish fair, but hidden away within the modern Irish fair was a tiny medieval camp. And the ruler of that camp was Queen Maeve, or that's what everyone called her. And she said, "No one's been coming to entertain me. And I've heard that you tell stories. Tell me one." And so I began a story, and her eyes lit up, and the people with her began to gather around. And at the end of telling her the story, she gave me one of the oddest bits of payment I've ever gotten for telling a story, which was a little medallion on a leather thong, and she said, "This is to let you know that I liked what you told, because I've never heard anyone tell that story before." Well, this was very strange because, you know, she was supposed to be the queen of all things traditional and Irish. But this is the story that I told her. And it's a story from an Irish tradition. In the English tradition, you have stories about boys named Jack. But in the Irish tradition, they're named Billy. And this was a story of a boy named Billy and his encounter with Rory the Robber. Now, Billy was a fine young lad, but he didn't have money because he didn't have a job, and jobs were scarce. There was only one job open to a lad like him, and that was a job not to be desired, for it was to be rent collector. Now, it wasn't that the landlord was such a bad man. He was actually a very nice one, but the job of rent collector was a hazardous one, and that was because when the rents got too big, they were the target of Rory the Robber. Now, Rory the Robber was a legendary highwayman. He had a small band of men with him, but more importantly, he thought very highly of himself. And he was reputed to have the second fastest horse in all Ireland. So you couldn't outrun him with the money. And he was a crack shot, and you couldn't outrun the pistols that he wore at his belt. So it was that Billy decided he had to take the job. He went to the landlord and said, "I need large saddlebags, a big floppy coat, and the slowest horse you can provide." The landlord understood the big saddlebags because you needed to put coins in them. Most of the peasants paid with coins. But a big floppy coat and the slowest horse he could provide? What did he have to lose? At least this way, it was a cheap horse. So he got Billy a cheap, slow horse, a big floppy coat, big saddlebags, and Billy went out to collect the rents. Well, there he rode the slow horse toward the properties owned by the landlord, and when he got to the place where there were trees positioned so that a whole band of robbers could be hiding behind those trees, one behind each one, he called out and said, "If Rory the robber is there, I don't have any money yet, but I'll be coming back this way." Laughter came from behind most of the trees. And from behind one of them, a voice boomed out, "Thank you for letting me know." Well, Billy went off and he collected rents from all the little properties. And true to his word, he came back to that same grove of trees along the road. When he got to that grove of trees, he said, "I'm back." And out from behind the biggest tree came Rory the robber on his fine horse, his cloak blowing in the carefully arranged breeze because he was on that side of the crossroads. You could see the silver pistols at his belt. He'd gotten off a captain of the army. And there he said, "Thank you for being so nice and announcing when you were coming. I don't want to hurt you, but I plan to take all your money." Now, while he was doing the rounds, gathering the money, Billy had sorted the coins into two groups. All the pennies he'd put into the saddlebags. Any larger coins he'd put into the pockets of his jacket. So it was, the gold and silver was all in his coat, and the pennies were in the saddlebags. And the saddlebags bulged with pennies. And Billy said, "Now I know you're going to rob me, and there's money in the saddlebags here, but I have to show that I put up a fight. So, I have an idea. Let me take off my jacket." And he took off the coat and held it out. "Now, I've heard that you're a crack shot. So if you could put a bullet through this sleeve here, just above the buttons." And Rory said, "Certainly, I can do that." And he pulled out one of his great silver flintlocks. Bang! And put a hole right through. And Billy looked at it. "Could you take a look at this and see if it would convince you?" And Rory got down off of his horse, walked over and said, "Yeah, that's pretty convincing, but it's just the one bullet hole. Perhaps I should do a second one." And Billy said, "Just the thing. How about over here with the cuff of the other sleeve?" And Rory pulled out his second pistol, bang, and put a hole through that. And Billy said, "That's absolutely perfect." Ran over, jumped on Rory's horse, and took off. Well, Rory thought, "What?" And he realized he'd just fired both of his pistols, and Billy was now riding the second fastest horse in all Ireland. Well, at least he had the saddlebags and this other horse, and he opened the saddlebag, and it was filled with pennies. So he thought, "I'll chase him." Jumped onto the horse that Billy had left behind, went, yeah, and it took a step. No, I said, yeah, and it took a couple of steps and continued ambling along at the same pace it had been walking when Billy had brought it, and nothing Rory could do would speed it up. Oh, he was angry, because now not only had Billy tricked him, but he'd stolen Rory's horse and left him with this. And he had a whole gang of outlaws hiding behind the trees, trying not to laugh, because they knew that Rory the robber was not to be messed with. Well, Billy rode all the way to the landlord's house and said, here, in the pockets of the coat are most of the rents. I had to give Rory the pennies. You had to do what? And that's not the horse I... Oh, dear Lord, that's Rory the robber's horse. Because this was a famous horse, of course. And Billy said, yes. You think he's angry? Maybe I'd better take the horse back to him. The landlord was stunned into silence. He accepted the coat, weighed down with coins of gold and silver, as Billy rode off, looking for Rory. Well, by this time, the horse that Billy had left behind had taken several more steps, but it still hadn't gotten very far from that grove of trees. And so the thunder of hoofbeats approaching, as Rory saw his own horse coming back with Billy on its back. And Billy said, here, I felt it only fair I should bring you your horse back. I didn't really mean to steal it, but I had to get away from you with the rest of the money. And Rory was stunned. Not only had this boy stolen his horse, but he'd brought it back. He said, I'll forgive you on one condition, that you join my outlaw band until I say it's time for you to leave. And by the way, I've reloaded my pistols. So it was that Billy joined the outlaw band for a while and lived the life of an outlaw. But you see, the reason the authorities could never catch Rory or his men was they were hidden away in caves in the hills. And it was to one of those caves that Rory took Billy and said, you'll stay here with me and my men. And he ordered one of his men, go out and steal a sheep so we can roast it. And that man went off to steal a sheep. And Billy said, what would you give me if I can steal it from him on his way back? And Rory said, if you can steal a sheep from him, the finest sheep rustler in all of Ireland, on his way back, I'll give you a bag of silver. And Billy said, okay, but I'll need a pair of shoes. You'll need a pair of shoes to steal a sheep? All right, this we've got to see. And they went over and rummaged in the loot that they'd stolen from many a person and found a nice pair of shoes. And Billy said, these will do. And ran off in the direction where the man had gone to steal a sheep. On his way back from stealing a sheep, the robber came along, and there in the middle of the path was a beautiful shoe. It was even close to his own size. It might fit him. So he thought, it's a great pity there's only one. And he walked along around a bend in the path, and there was a second shoe. Two.
One.
Two. That's the right number of shoes. So he tied the sheep to a bush, picked up the shoe, and went back to make sure they were a pair. Where Billy came out of the bushes, untied the sheep, and took it back to the cave. Well, the robber came back with a pair of shoes and no sheep. When he got back to the cave, all of the other robbers were laughing and said, we can't eat shoes. All right, I'll go steal another one. So he left the shoes and went back. Got back and to where the sheep were, and Billy had said to Rory, what'll you give me if I can steal that one too? For that, I'd give you a bag of gold if you could pull this off again. And he said, all right, I just need the string that I used to bring this one back. And he took the string off the first sheep and took it back out. And the robber was bringing the sheep back along the same pathway, and he saw there, hanging from a bush, the same string that he'd used on the first sheep. He must have gotten loose. And from in the distance, way in the distance in the bushes, he heard, "Baa! Baa! I'll tie this sheep up to the same string and find the first one." And he did, and he went off into the bushes. Well, by this time, Billy had crawled round, and as the robber went deeper into the bushes, Billy came up on the walkway, grabbed the second sheep, and took it back to the cave. Well, now Rory was just thrilled with Billy as a thief, and they laughed when the sick man brought back, again, no sheep, and they said, "That's all right, we've got two others." And after a fine feast, Rory said to Billy, "If you can help me steal a horse, you can go back to your home with the bag of silver and the bag of gold." "Well, all right, so what horse is it?" "It's the horse of the Lord of Connaught." "Oh, you see, the horse of the Lord of Connaught was the only horse in all of Ireland reputed to be faster than Rory the robber's horse." So he thought, all right, to steal that horse, we'll need a jug of drugged poteen to make people sleep, a bandana, and a harp. Well, Rory could not figure out how this would work, but after two successful tries, he figured, I'll give him the chance. And so they rummaged and found what they needed, a great big jug of absolutely stomach-splitting Irish whiskey with enough drugs in it to make a horse sleep. He said, "No, no, it's not for the horse." "All right." And they went off to find the Lord of Connaught's fine, fine house. Now, one of the traditions in Ireland was that if you happened to see a blind musician, you would bring him into your home to eat and drink and sleep. And so it was that Billy arranged the bandana around Rory's eyes and had him carry the harp, which was badly out of tune, but, you know, these things happen. And there they came to the Lord of Connaught's house. It was a big house with walls around it, stables, guards, and there they were invited in. And Billy said, "My master, the poor blind harper, is very tired and not well. Perhaps he could wait until tomorrow to play for you, but would you still give us a place to sleep tonight and perhaps a bit of bread?" Well, the Lord of Connaught said, "Of course." And so the blind harper and his servant Billy were brought in, and that night the Lord of Connaught feasted as he typically did. Well, Billy took the jug of whiskey out to where the guards were guarding the walls and the stables and said, "There's a party going on inside. I can only bring you a little bit to drink. Would that be good?" And they each tasted. And oh, it went down so smoothly. And oh, it was so tasty. And oh, as they leaned against the walls, they fell sound asleep. And so it was that late that night, Billy and Rory went into the stables where no one was awake to guard and stole the fastest horse in all of Ireland and took it back to the robber's cave. Well, Rory kept his word. Billy was given a bag of silver and a bag of gold, and Rory's free will to go. Now, by this point, the Lord of Connaught was just the tiniest bit upset, and it alerted all the guards and soldiers in the district. So Rory retired from the bandit business and became a horse farmer. And so it was that the finest racing horses in all of Ireland to this day were descended from the horse of Rory the Robber and the one that Billy stole from the Lord of Connaught. Well, that was the story that Queen Maeve had never heard. And so it was that she gave me the medallion on the leather thong and told all of her minions, "This man is a storyteller. Listen to him and bring him back next time." And so it was that I got a royal favor from someone I'd never met before. The most unusual pay I've ever received for telling a story. And it was the story of Billy and Rory the Robber.